This is Roosevelt Gist with Auto Network coming to you live from Charlotte, North Carolina. Auto Network Live is designed to inform, educate, motivate, and mobilize you, the automotive consumer. Hopefully the information that we give you will do at least one of those for you. We have a great show again this week for you. A couple of special guests coming up later on in the show. But let's get right into our buying tip of the week. Your credit report, is it a real reflection of you? The single most critical document used to determine your credit is your credit report. Your FICO score is determined by this. Is your credit report an accurate reflection of you, but more importantly, of your past buying habits? Is it a true reflection of your past debt payment history? With identity theft on the rise, you may want to review your credit report at least every 6 months. How your credit report is reported will make the difference between your getting a new or used car loan as well as the interest rate. All that's needed to access this information is your Social Security number. Some of the information listed on your credit report is the name of the business that reported the information, the credit that was extended to you, the date the account was opened, the date it closed, the type of account, the terms of the account, the high amount loan, the balance, the amount past due, your payment profile, inquiries from other businesses, ex-spouse accounts, judgments, and dispute comments. As you can see, if you don't know what's on your credit report, you could be denied a car loan because of inaccurate information. Within the volumes of information being sent to credit bureaus daily, costly mistakes can be made. Computers make it easy for auto dealers to access your credit report while you sit in the dealership or you're out on a test drive. If you refuse a new or used car loan, the lender is required to send you a letter of denial. This letter lists the name of the credit bureau that reported your credit information. And the salesperson should not discuss the specific reasons for denying you the credit. Under the Fair Credit Act, you are entitled to a copy of your credit report. The report is free if you enclose a copy of your denial letter. You may also request a copy by calling the credit bureau or visiting their website. But in these two situations, a fee may be charged. Before going to purchase your new or used car, get a copy of your credit report and review the information for accuracy. There's a dispute procedure outlined on the back of the report. It is not wise to visit several dealerships and let them run credit reports because numerous inquiries are not looked upon favorably by lenders. And in these economic times and with what's going on in the credit industry, you want to do everything possible to make the lender looking at your credit information more interested in providing you a loan because of your good credit report. You know, this week I was thinking about Auto Network and the show, what we do, and I realized we have the largest selection of new car introductions on the web than anybody. I mean anybody. And what's a new car introduction? That's where car companies invite journalists literally from around the world to a specific location. It may be here in the States, or it may be in some other country, where we're given a formal presentation by the car company on that particular product. There may be engineers there, designers, a lot of car company executives, and they talk about the product in a formal setting, more like a classroom setting. And there's a Q&A section and session, and after that we go out and drive the car for the balance of the day. Now these ride and drives that I attend, I videotape them and put them up on our website, autonetwork.com, in the ride and drive section, and you can go in there and watch the presentation by presenter. I only edit it by presenter. I don't edit their specific comments or content. So if you really want to know what the car company says about a particular car, then you can go to autonetwork.com, click on the ride and drive, and take a look at it, as well as review the comments that your local or favorite automotive journalist may have said about that particular product. And I also do a review and give my opinion of the product, regardless of what the car company may have said. And along those lines, speaking of car reviews, let's move right along to Mr. Greg Morrison for our Car of the Week. And as always, if you're first time watching the show, you know I pick up the phone like so and literally make a phone call. Let's see if Mr. Greg Morrison is sitting around, and let's see what Greg's going to talk about today for the Car of the Week.
Good morning, Roosevelt.
Greg. Man, you answered on the first ring. Hello? You there?
Roosevelt, can you hear me?
Can you hear me?
Now I can. How are you today?
Hey, I'm sitting here wondering what's going to happen next.
We'll figure it out.
As you know, there's always something that happens when you do these live shows, man. The technology is good, but ooh.
That's the fun.
Hey, what's our car of the week, buddy?
370Z by Nissan.
Oh man, if you listened to the first part of the show, I was just telling people about the ride and drive.
Well, the ride and drive was only part of the fun. You know, talking to the execs, driving the car was just, oh my God. Got a chance to drive the new 370Z from Nissan, which comes with a 332 horsepower V6 engine. It's the biggest engine Nissan's ever put in this power plant. They've also come up with a couple of variations on their transmission. There's now a 7-speed automatic and a 6-speed manual transmission that has rev matching. Having driven a lot of manual transmissions in my life, it was a pleasant surprise to find a car, especially a performance car, that when you start to downshift, it automatically does the rev matching for you. So when you want to downshift into your next gear, it's there. It matches up perfectly. You're not fighting the car to get it in the right gear and the right speed. Very pleasant experience with this vehicle. Ironically, this Z, the interior is just phenomenal. Very upscale, very well done, but doesn't get too far from the Z roots, which is a fun, basic car to drive. They can give you high tech, but if you want just a car, a basic one, let's rip, and you still get a lot of quality products in it. The other thing we found is the handling on this car is just right where it should be. Quite often cars, if you're driving them, when you make a turn, you have to sort of wait for the back end to catch up with you.
Right.
With this vehicle, the center point is literally right under the driver's butt. So when you turn, it goes. Very responsive handling, and we even got a chance to try it out on a high-performance racetrack out in Parham, Nevada, and it could take the corners without any problem. In fact, it begged to be thrashed. Overall, Nissan has probably outdone themselves technically with this car as far as what they can put in it. The big challenge they're going to face, as you've discussed earlier, is the issue of credit and being able to get people in the showrooms who can afford to buy the car. Starting price on it is $29,930, and a fully loaded one, while they haven't released official pricing, I'm guesstimating will probably be about $37,000. So it's not a bad deal overall.
Right. Now, I had the opportunity last week to, it was last week. Time flies when you're having fun, I guess, to drive the Z. And I found that one of the things that I noticed, the car was extremely quiet. And for a sports car, the ride was exceptionally smooth. It's not like you get to really feel the bounce and the grooves in the highway. What was your experience?
I agree with you. The NVH, or noise vehicle level, harshness level, was much lower. I was riding with another journalist, and we were able to hold a conversation at normal tones and without shouting to hear each other. And you have to understand, this Z, unlike the other one, doesn't have that stabilizer bar right behind the driver's seat, which sort of locked the back end down.
Right.
So there was a big open cavern back there that you would figure would create a noise problem. Not at all. The ride, much better, better handling, better dampening and suspension on the springs. And the brakes are surprisingly good for non-premium brakes from a maker. Normally, automakers will go to someone like Brembo to make brakes for high-performance vehicles.
Right.
Nissan opted this time to go with their own high-performance brakes, which seemed to work just as well. And while we're out on the track, there were some moments where you had to do some hard braking. I did not see any of these catching fire or smoking during that maneuver.
Greg, what excited you the most about driving the Z?
I'm old enough to remember the 240, and I'm showing my age here. But it's a flashback to that very simple, pure pleasure. But the, what I liked about it the most was you felt like you were in control of a car, and you could look down. You're in fifth gear. You're clipping along 85, 90 miles an hour, and it's not breathing hard. You put it up in the sixth gear, 100 miles an hour is not difficult, but when you needed that extra oomph, it was there. It was what fun driving should be. What I found it interesting was that this is a performance car that you can basically put in your driveway and take to work every day for less than $35,000.
Great. Greg, appreciate the comments on the 370Z. We won't be doing a show next week because of Christmas, so I want to say Merry Christmas
holiday
to you and the family.
Thank you, my friend.
And I'll catch you maybe the week after.
Sounds like a bet. You take care, buddy.
Great. Thanks, Greg. Appreciate it.
Bye-bye.
Greg Morrison, our car of the week, the 370Z. Phenomenal ride. It's moving right along here. Let's get to, who are we going to next? I guess it must be Mr. Frank Washington. And Frank will do our weekly commentary. Let me see if I can ring Frank here. Hopefully he's sitting in Detroit waiting for this phone call. It's always a challenge to see whether people will be there or not. But Frank is a reliable kind of guy. Hopefully. Oh, Frank.
Hello?
Frank.
Hey.
What's happening, man?
How are you? Hold on a minute. I'm in a part of the house.
Uh-oh. Okay.
Where the reception isn't that great. How you doing, sir?
Hey, man, I'm hanging. How about you?
Man, I'm looking at this snow. No,
snow.
The threat of snow. The sand is most likely. So I'm thinking about, well, maybe I should get some salt out in the morning.
Uh-oh.
And get ready for the weather.
Yeah, that's all, you know, well, as you are aware, Detroit Auto Show is coming up next month, and that's the biggest concern with everybody is whether the snow will be there or not.
Yeah, you know, it's an interesting thing this year. I guess the bottom line of it is that the weather, we're having weather here that we normally don't get until January, sometimes even February.
Right.
Because it's been less than 30 degrees for more than a week, maybe a week and a half to 2 weeks. We may get some snow, you know, but we don't get what's expected, or at least what's being threatened by tomorrow night.
Certainly.
Which is up to 6 to 10 inches is what's being threatened anyway.
Okay.
So as I say, it's you know, everybody's holding their breath. The car companies certainly are throwing the curve in the sense they're taking off, because they normally, take a break.
Certain.
For 2 weeks around Christmas anyway.
Yeah.
But, Chrysler has extended that to for another 2 weeks. Chrysler's going to be down for a month, something like December 19th to January 19th or 20th. Ford is extending it 2 weeks to 3 weeks. I don't think we've heard word from General Motors yet, you know, and you kind of it's one of those things where, in some sense, this is normal. You know, the auto companies have extended that before, but I guess the timing is such that you kind of wonder, you know, what's going on.
Yeah.
In the sense of is this PR, if you will, in terms of trying to force? I don't know whether it be force or justify the loans that they're trying to get from the house, or are they truly in trouble in the sense of in trouble in the sense of the wolf is knocking on the door, so to speak. So that's what's going on. You know, it was an interesting thing. I'm looking for something right now, because at the same time that this was going on, I was really looking at what was going on in Sweden, in the sense that the government there approved something like, it was like $2 billion in loans, not so much loans, but in credit for the auto companies there. You know, basically it says, you know, while the U.S. leaves its domestic auto industry twisting in the wind, Sweden has stepped up to the plate. According to Automotive News Europe, the Scandinavian country has agreed to provide up to 25 billion kroner, that's 2.36 billion euros, in credit guarantees and emergency loans to Swedish automakers Saab and Volvo. The two automakers must apply for the loans, and both said they would make a decision soon. I sometimes think that, you know, since both are owned by American automakers, the question becomes, will those loans go to the Swedish automakers or will they go to the American automakers?
Right.
That's because Saab is owned by General Motors and Ford is owned, and Ford owns Volvo. Both American automakers have indicated that they would put their Swedish counterparts up for sale. So that might kind of ease those loans through, if you will. The cash may also help suppliers get through the tough times. The Swedish parliament will vote on the proposals next week, but they said the package meant that there would be no state takeover of Saab or Volvo, and it seems there will be no bankruptcy either. The money will take the form of a 3 billion kroner investment in a state-owned research and development company. The government will also provide 20 billion kroner in credit guarantees to auto companies to borrow money from the European Investment Bank for use in developing green technology. The final part of the plan is to provide rescue loans of up to 5 billion kroner for auto companies facing collapse. Now, keep in mind, you know, we're talking about Swedish auto companies, and there are only two. So, you know, when you take that money and spread it out over two companies, that's a substantial hit. When I say hit, it's a substantial help, rather,
right,
in helping those two auto companies stay afloat, either as independents, you know, in terms of other people buying them out, but certainly in the face of being sold by GM and, GM and Ford, which right now I would think they might welcome. But anyway, that's what you do when you're trying to save your country's financial derriere, which is a bit of pragmatism that seems lost on the U.S. Congress. That's what I'm thinking today.
Okay, Frank, as always, some good food for thought. We won't be on next week because it's Christmas, so I wish you and your family a Merry Christmas, and I'll catch you later. I know I'll see you on the road.
I appreciate that, and same to you, brother.
Take care. Frank Washington, our commentary for the week. Moving right along, we're going to have a special guest on the show. And when you talk about numbers in the industry, this guy provides some of the best in the industry, Mr. George Pippas, who's a manager of sales analysis and reporting for Ford. Hopefully George is waiting for my phone call. Let me see if I can grab him right quick. And we'll have a nice long conversation with George. How you arrive at these numbers, and what do they mean to you, the consumer? And important, just as important to the car companies.
Hello?
George Roosevelt, how are you, sir?
Hi, Roosevelt.
Happy
Good
holidays
morning.
To you. You there?
Yes, indeed. Can you hear me?
I can hear you now. I'm playing around with these controls here. You know, as you know, when you see me, I do everything, the audio, the video, and YouTube. It's all on me.
Well, so then I can replay it later, huh?
Of course you can. We're live right now. George, why don't you take a quick moment and tell us exactly what does your job entail? I have here you're the manager of sales analysis and reporting. What is that?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. My job at Ford is to analyze sales trends and the U as it relates specifically to the U.S. market, and discuss these trends with Ford management and outsiders. I've been with Ford for 32 years, so I've seen a lot. You know, this current situation is very reminiscent of another situation that the industry went through in the early 80s. And so, you know, it's to provide guidance to people like yourself, Wall Street analysts, and the business press, as well as Ford management, as to what might be ahead and where consumers might be taking us.
Now, George, where do you get this data?
Well, there's a lot of sources of data. I mean, it begins with the manufacturer's reports of sales.
But
we
all
also have information that bubbles up from our retailers, our own retailers and other retailers. We look at economic data that's available, you know, that's released periodically from the government, and try to understand how the economic data are going to impact our industry. So it's multiple sources, both government and information supplied by manufacturers and their retailers.
Now, how often do you collect this data?
Oh, it's well, these days, Roosevelt, it's daily. things are happening so fast in the U.S. economy and in the auto industry that we monitor the incoming data on a daily basis. And it's so volatile right now. So many things are happening each day when we begin our day and look at the overnight news. There's always something different. Like today, for example, it would appear that maybe the merger talks between GM and Chrysler are back on. There's information about the actions that the Federal Reserve has taken. People are waiting to see what the Bush administration is going to do as it relates to the short-term needs of GM and Chrysler, obviously pertaining to their situation with regard to cash to keep going, to keep in business. And so it's perpetual motion right now,
right,
in the U.S. economy and in the U.S. auto industry.
Now, how accurate is the information, George?
Well, the data is always pretty accurate. It's the interpretation.
That was my next question.
It's the interpretation of the data that is left to our judgments and different people. A group of intelligent people can look at the same data, and you can get as many different opinions and conclusions about it as there are people in that group. And so that's where it becomes it's art, not just science. So the incoming data is good, but how one analyzes it, and in large part, that's part of my job. It's to try to, and I certainly do have a fair amount of help with this, thankfully, but it's our job to analyze the incoming data and try to make sense of it in a way that, you know, in a way that can help us be predictive and proactive about what consumers are going to do, when we might see the recovery, when we might see a bottom in the U.S. economy and auto sales, and that's the exciting part. That's the interesting part, is trying to apply, you know, your experience and judgment to the facts.
George, what are some of the things that can really have an impact on the data? Let's take for an example the credit situation that people say we're going through now, even though I talk to dealers and they say that credit is available, as well as the price of gas. As you've seen, it's gone up and down from over $5 in the last 3 months to now some places is less than a dollar. How does that impact your data?
Well, you've mentioned a couple of items there, and those are just two of the many items that have an impact on data. We can discuss those another. I think one of the key things right now that even goes beyond gas and goes beyond credit, but certainly those are interesting topics to delve into because they have such a big impact on our business, is I would say the most important factor right now is consumer confidence.
Okay.
As we all know, as many of your listeners I'm sure can relate to from a personal situation, I know I can as well, is as consumers, as people making decisions about whether or not they can buy a car, they right now are very, very cautious. Consumer sentiment is at a historic low level, and understandably so, because in the last year or year and a half, we're bombarded with information that tells us our home price, the price of our home, which in many cases is the biggest asset some people have, that the price of our home has declined, that the retirement savings that we've worked so hard to build up over these years has some of that has evaporated. And to top it all off, many are concerned about the job, the prospect for future employment.
Certainly.
The job market reports, the job losses and unemployment right now seems to be accelerating. So with concerns about your household situation with regard to home prices and retirement savings, and now throw on top of that concerns about employment, people are very reluctant to pull the trigger. Even if their credit situation is good, a car purchase is a significant purchase. And not only in autos, Roosevelt, but we've seen recent reports from retailers in this holiday Christmas season that people are putting off purchasing any kind of a big ticket item because of concerns they have about their future employment and the need to save, to recoup some of the retirement savings that have dissolved. So, excuse me. So that right now is the biggest factor on auto sales. It's compounded by, this situation is compounded by a very serious a credit situation. I think the financial system right now, while perhaps, you know, you could argue it's fundamentally sound, perhaps, it's still, there's a lot of uncertainty and shakiness. You know, this recent scandal with this investment firm.
Yes.
The $50 billion. I mean, I think that testifies to the concerns that people have about our financial system and banks' willingness to lend credit because many of their assets, with home prices having declined, are on thin ice.
Now, so, George, even in all of these situations that you just described, at the end of the day, Ford still has to sell Fords. So based on all of that, what do you tell the Ford executives to tell the marketing people to tell the consumers about buying Fords?
Well, fortunately, right now we have a very strong story to tell. First, I guess it starts with emphasizing to the public, to our dealers, and to the people in Washington, that we think we can make it through this situation on our own, to pull ourselves up by our own bootstraps. Thankfully, our liquidity is strong. We don't have an immediate need for cash. We do not intend to borrow from the government. That is not our plan. We have sufficient cash, we believe, to take us through this very difficult period. And I think that's an important message to deliver to consumers and dealers and the public, because they want to buy a vehicle from a company they can trust, that they think is going to be in business, and that fundamentally is going to be there for them, somebody they can trust. We've tried to differentiate ourselves in that regard among the automakers. That's point one. Point two is, Roosevelt, is we have a unique opportunity now because of all the work that's been done over the past two or three years on some very important factors, car buying decisions that consumers value. I would say first and foremost is the quality of our vehicles. Some important third-party endorsements have been received in the last 60 days, I guess most notably from Consumer Reports, which a lot of car buyers rely on, and their judgment is that the quality of Ford cars is now equal to, on par, some cases better than Toyota and Honda. Now, perception is not close to that. And that's an important message. When you talked about messages to deliver to consumers and dealers, to get the word out that Ford quality improvements over the past several years have put us in a position where we're right there with the best of the best is an important message. Another important consumer consideration is safety of their vehicle. How safe are they in the vehicle? And here, too, again, just in the last month, the Insurance Institute for Safety and also NHTSA have judged Ford cars to be the safest. Ford has more models that have received top safety picks from a very tough critic, the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety, as having more top picks than any other manufacturer. Now, add to that fuel economy,
right,
where Ford's full-size pickup, our small utility vehicle, the Escape, and the hybrid version of that product, and the new Ford Fusion that's going to be in dealer showrooms in the spring, having fuel economy that far surpasses Honda and Honda's Accord and Toyota's Camry. These kinds of endorsements and ratings start to break down myths about our cars not being fuel efficient, our cars not being safe, or our cars not having quality that's up to the best of the best. So right now, as we are in the midst of a very strong product cadence in 2008, 9, and 10, it's very important to get these messages out. That's where we think where we have the most leverage, and we can tap into, I think, what is an underlying equity in the Ford brand.
Now, George, when did Ford decide to, I guess, spend the money and the time and the effort to make those changes that you just described? I mean, it's something that you would think a car company would have built into their product originally, but when did you all sit back and say, hey, these are the three to four things that we definitely have to change?
Well, it was always there, Roosevelt, but I think that the leadership that emerged at Ford in the middle part of this decade, was a very strong catalyst. And by middle part of this decade, I think it started with Mark Fields, who's president of Ford's automotive operations in North and South America. Mark had a substantial amount of experience at Mazda leading their recovery and revitalization in Japan. And he became president of the Americas in late 2005. And so many of the lessons learned with regard to Mazda's recovery and emergence as a significant worldwide brand were put to the test here in North America. This, I think, also part of that thinking was the idea that we had for a long time been successful and built very good products in the truck and SUV category. But by our own admission, and by Alan Mulally's admission in Washington, we didn't pay a lot of attention to keeping our cars, our passenger cars, fresh, updated, contemporary. Much of our investment in the 90s and early part of this decade, the very early part of the decade, Roosevelt, as you well know from having been to many Ford programs, was tilted towards trucks and SUVs. Well, at the time, it seemed like a good idea. Gas prices right. were low. Many segments of the U.S. population had families, larger households, and I'm going to contrast that in a few minutes with something that's quite different now. But family vehicles, larger vehicles, were very much in vogue beginning in the 80s with minivans, later sport utility vehicles. So it was a business formula that at the time seemed to make sense and tapped into consumers' desire for those types of vehicles. But things change. Lots of things change. I think one of the most significant changes that drove our thinking as it relates to where are we going to invest money in the future, trucks or cars, is the idea that the largest segment of our population, which is the baby boomers,
yes.
It's a segment that's about 75 million, and they buy a disproportionate amount of the new vehicles in the United States. Baby boomers were aging. Well, we all are, aren't we? Sad
Certain.
Fact of life.
Yeah, look at both our images on the screen here.
What's that?
I said you can look at both of our images on the screen here.
Well, that's right. I think I'm the prototype. I might be the oldest baby boomer on the planet. In any case, as we aged, our households were getting smaller. We were becoming, entering a new life stage called empty nesterdom, huh? Children flying the coop, leaving the home, and this large group of people who buy a disproportionate number of the vehicles in the United States didn't need vehicles as large as they once had when they had a household full of children and their friends. So our view, the view emerged at Ford that if we were going to tap into this group, it was important to broaden our portfolio, not just larger vehicles, but smaller and mid-sized vehicles, and also crossovers. I remember a discussion we had in San Francisco when the Ford Edge was introduced,
right.
a utility vehicle that was actually based on a car platform. Turned out to be a very successful product for us, and this product was really in response to a recognition that boomers weren't going to drive the same size or same type of vehicles that they did in the 80s and 90s. Now, at the same time in the middle part of this decade, fuel prices started to inch up. Not so dramatically at first, but we saw a real acceleration in fuel prices this summer, and now, of course, they're back down. But the view emerged at Ford that Americans were going to be downsizing, in part in response to new life stages that they were entering, but also because energy was not going to be as cheap as it was in the 80s and 90s. And this is about the time, in fact, about the very time that you and I met in San Francisco, that Alan Mulally was hired from Boeing to further lead Ford's global revitalization. And his view was, you know, the beauty of having Alan come to Ford is the he asked some very simple questions, like, why don't we build the cars that are so successful for us in Europe, why don't we build those in the United States? And, you know, we probably had a lot of traditional responses, reasons why we should or shouldn't do it. And his point of view, I think, was governed by the fact that at Boeing, they wouldn't spend so much time researching and developing a new airplane and have a separate one for France and have another one for the United States and redesign a whole new, you know, 737 for Asia. There's so much front-end research and development that goes into a vehicle, and even more for an airplane, that it makes sense to design and engineer it once and then build it in the markets that you sell it. And that, Roosevelt, is one of the linchpins of Ford's strategy now. And the very first fruit of that strategy we're going to see in 2009 in the U.S. when we start to sell the small, we call it, the name is the Transit Van.
Okay.
That is the top-selling commercial vehicle, a very light, very fuel-efficient van, actually sort of based on a kind of a C-car platform, which is like a Focus-sized product, but it's ideal for urban, commercial applications. Not so much heavy-duty commercial applications, but things like florist delivery, just for an example, parcel delivery. And so that will be the first product. But then comes the cars. And in 2010, we will start building in North America the Ford Fiesta, which I'm sure you know from having followed automotive events and products on a worldwide basis, that this car is being heralded in Europe as the next game changer in small cars. The Fiesta is a car that's smaller than our current Focus, and later in 2010, we will start building in the United States the Ford Focus, the
okay.
same car researched, designed, and engineered in Europe, but manufactured and assembled in North America. And so U.S. consumers will find out what European consumers already know, that we build and design cars that people really want to drive in areas of the world where fuel prices are high, where fuel efficiency is viewed as a real selling point. And we're going to go ahead and continue. We don't care whether gas falls to a dollar. This is going to be a key strategy for us because small cars are where many young buyers go for their first vehicle. And it's really important for us to tap into people who are entering the vehicle market, not just people like me, you know, boomers, the boomer generation that is older, yes, that generation, but also we need to tap into the people who are just beginning to make their first decisions about what brand of vehicle to buy.
George, talk a little bit about two products that I'm really interested in. One is the Flex. How did that come about? And the other is what's Ford's position in the truck market?
Well, with regard to the Flex, this was a product that was developed off of the same platform that we build our Taurus, and it's a crossover utility. Therefore, it's considered to be a larger crossover, and the feeling was is that people who in the 90s purchased Explorers and Expeditions might be interested in a product that has some size and up to three rows of seating, but is more fuel efficient. As a matter of fact, Flex leads its segment with 24 mpg highway, and the car has done very well for us. Not so much in terms of its sales volumes, because there aren't many products right now whose sales volumes are as high as, you know, what we had come to almost take for granted, you know, when industry sales were much higher.
Yes.
But interestingly, the Flex has been successful in bringing people to the Ford brand that are new to our brand. Its distinctive styling and I think its level of craftsmanship has attracted people who are trading other brands of vehicles. It's attracting them at a rate which we haven't seen for any other Ford vehicle. Almost 60% of the people that purchase the Ford Flex are trading a product from another brand. And so while the sales volumes to this point, and maybe understandably so given the current economic situation, have not, it's not been a home run in terms of its sales volumes, but within its segment, it's gaining share, and importantly, it's adding new customers to the Ford family. And I think it's the kind of product with its distinctive styling that you know, has an opportunity to turn heads. Maybe you may have had some experience with it. Almost every consumer that I talk to, and some don't know I'm from Ford Motor Company, but whenever I see a Flex, and if I can catch up with the owner, I'll just innocently ask them where they obtained their vehicle, and the reaction I get from these customers is, if it goes something like this: if we had a dollar for everybody that asked us about the car we're driving, we could make our monthly payment each month. It's a real head turner.
It is a head turner,
and I think it's the progress. We're actually looking forward to our best sales month of the year so far, in the month of December. So we're very high on this product and what it's doing for Ford dealers and our company's image. The truck market has really had a tough time in these past couple of years. I guess that could be said for any segment, but the truck market, Roosevelt, really is so dependent on the level of residential construction. And as we all know, the home market has been quite weak. New home construction has fallen sharply from its peak levels in 2005 and 2006. And this has really taken a toll on the full-size truck market. Nonetheless, the people that are buying trucks today are more likely than ever to be people that rely on these products for making a living. It's an asset in their business. And so we designed the new F-150, which is just now in dealer showrooms. We sold our first ones in October, now more in November, and I'm sure, I'm quite confident that the sales are going to rise again in December. This is the new F-150. Recently, just this week, received Motor Trend's Truck of the Year in October. It was judged to be the truck of Texas by the Texas Auto Writers Association. And as we, as most of us know, who follow the business, Texas is like the biggest truck market in the United States.
Exactly.
And so the new F-150 is off to a great start. And here again, we see Ford improving its current. This is not a new nameplate for us, obviously, but it's a redesigned, all new, and I guess it goes without saying, people probably know that listen to your program that F Series we're gonna soon cap the 32nd year as the best selling truck, 27 years in a row as the best selling vehicle, car or truck in the United States. We've added more capability. It has the most towing capability, the most payload capability, and you can get all that with the best fuel economy of any light-duty pickup truck, 21 mpg highway. So we tried to take it to the next level, not only in terms of capability, but fuel economy. And so far, the accolades from people who have driven and have put the truck to the test, a lot of pickuptrucks.com and a lot of websites who are in the business of evaluating trucks say that this is the best ever. And of course, when you've got a name like F-Series, which is almost synonymous with our company, you wouldn't want to let your customers down the next time you redesign a truck. And we hope that people will be pleased and satisfied and proud to own this new product.
George, why don't you give you some final thoughts, some final positive thoughts to consumers that are listening to this webcast about
the message
two
for
things.
Consumers,
one would be the industry.
Yeah, right. I think what we've got to I guess the message for consumers is we're certainly expecting these next few months as we enter 2009 to continue to be challenging economically. But I guess what I'd like to assure them is that notwithstanding the present situation, I've been with Ford for 32 years. I've never been more optimistic about our future. We are building really outstanding quality products, safe, more fuel efficient with every new product that's designed. And we're not in a dry period. There's going to be lots of new product news. The next bit of new product news that I think people will be interested in is this new Fusion, which has already been quite successful for us. But the fuel economy from both the gas and for the first time ever, a hybrid is going to be offered in the Fusion are just examples of the kinds of products and product leadership that they're going to be seeing at their Ford, Lincoln, and Mercury dealer as we roll out into 2009 and look, you know, not to dismiss the current product lineup, but those new small cars that are becoming in 2010 at the beginning of that year are really going to be world-class in every respect and products that I think people will be proud to own. People will give us a look and give us consideration, put us on their shopping list, and I'm pretty confident that we're going we won't disappoint.
Great, George. Thanks for taking the time. Happy holidays to you and your family.
Same to you.
And I'm
Same
sure I'll see you on
glad
the road someplace.
Caught up with me, and we could have a chance to chat again.
Great. Thanks, George.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Mr. George Pippas from Ford. George crunches all the numbers for Ford Motor Company. Running a little behind. Let's see if we can catch up with Randy Payton and find out what's hot on Wheels, Inc. Hopefully Randy is waiting for the call. He was on a show, as a matter of fact, Tuesday. Had some very interesting comments about this bailout situation. as it affects consumers and as it affects auto dealers? What do we have? Music? Randy.
Hello.
Randy Roosevelt.
Oh, hey, Roosevelt.
Hey, man, what's happening? Did I catch you at a bad time?
Yeah, it is a bad time.
Well, I'm running a little late on the show, so got a couple of minutes to tell us what's hot on Wheels, Inc. this week?
Well, yeah, we're in Detroit trying to finish up on plans for the Urban Wheel Awards. I'm not sure how it's going to impact us with the recent news about Chrysler shutting down its North American plants and GM going on a hiatus until January 19th, things like that. As you know, there's a lot of attendees of our event here in Detroit.
Certainly.
This whole auto industry thing is having a major impact across the board on a lot of different things. So I'm hoping that it doesn't get so bad that the next administration will be able to recover. I hope they're not being set up for failure.
Well, I listened to Warren Brown's show Tuesday. You were on there with some other people. What's your feelings from that conversation that you all had on the roundtable discussion Tuesday?
Well, that the impact is much broader than is being reported in the news and that consumers are aware of. My gut feeling is that, meaning the problem, and I did an interview with a Greek TV station yesterday, the media is so that brought into this whole mismanagement and all these other issues that are not relevant. The real issue is that these companies cannot sell cars because consumers cannot get credit. That's what it's really about. It's not that the big three can don't make cars people don't want. Over 53% of all vehicles bought in the U.S. are made by domestic manufacturers. So that's misinformation. And so the issue is for everybody, all auto companies, that consumers cannot get credit, small businesses cannot get credit, the auto companies can't get credit, that the problem is in the banking industry.
So we should shine the spotlight on the banking industry.
Yes, that's the problem. And that's what needs to be fixed, and that's what needs to be regulated. And they need to rescue or assist the auto companies so we can maintain these jobs and businesses and all the social and educational programs that these companies support.
Right.
While they catch up and try to regulate the banking industry.
Okay. Well, I'll let you get back to your work at hand in Detroit. I appreciate you taking a few minutes, and I'll see you in Detroit in January.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, take care, Randy.
Goodbye.
Randy Payton, On Wheels, Inc. Randy's probably one of the only minority media companies that has focused on the auto industry and primarily what it's done for consumers and in the minority community. And Randy will be the first to tell you that the domestic auto companies literally built the urban communities by offering jobs to African Americans, paying equal wages to those employees that other businesses did not even come close to. Well, let's see if we can catch Al Vasquez at FAMA. See if Al's sitting around waiting to tell us what's happening on FAMA this week. Hopefully he is. I keep getting this dial tone up so high. Sooner or later I'll be able to regulate all of this equipment here. dial the number? Oh, there it is. Okay, Al, pick up. Moving right along.
Hi, this is Al. Please leave your name and number, and I will get back to you soon.
Oh. He won't get back to us. Okay, I know when I'm running behind, sometimes people are on a busy schedule, and I know I can't get to them exactly on the minute, but I try and get it as close to the time that's allotted. Who's next? Kamatney Rollins, Automotive Rhythms. Hopefully Kay's sitting around. He's a busy young brother, always on the road. See if I can find him. See if I can get Kamatney on the line. A lot of you watching this will say, why didn't this guy have a producer that can do all of this? A lot more fun calling people, dialing numbers. Anybody can have a producer. Well, it's ringing. Like my contributors ran away.
Your call has been forwarded
this week. Well, let's jump out to the West Coast, see if Chris Jones at Street Fire is sitting around. Maybe, well, on the West Coast, Chris is probably just waking up. See what we can come up with Chris. Having a hard time dialing here this morning. Need a speed dial phone. See if I can wake Chris up. Okay, Chris, pick up. Well, we have one more shot. Try Mr. Donald Bufamante. See what Donald has to say if he's around. If not, we'll go into something else. I have all day.
Your call has been forwarded
even
to an automatic
don't.
Voice message system. Oh. 858.
Donald's not even available. Boy, the contributors for the last half of the show, I'm going to have a conversation with those folks. But anyway, I hope you enjoyed the first half of the show. We had Mr. George Pippas on talking about crunching the numbers at Ford and where Ford will be heading in the future product. Normally, you don't get car company executives talking about future product. That's one of the things that they just don't do with journalists. But as you can see, I guess George had a little confidence in me, and he felt that he could mention a few products that you could get some firsthand information on. We also had Greg Morrison on talking about the 370Z, and you can actually go to autonetwork.com, go to the Ride and Drives, and watch our video of the 370Z introduction. And the video is playing, part of the video is on the screen now where I shot a walk around of the car. And we had Frank Washington on for our weekly commentary talking about what's happening in other markets where other governments are bailing out or helping their car companies to survive. So this whole economic situation is a global situation. And I've always said cars are global products now. You get parts coming from everywhere, all around the world to make an automobile. So you rarely can find a pure car anymore. So what affects consumers here and businesses here in the United States, it affects businesses around the world. If China now sneezes, other countries catch a cold. So this is Roosevelt Gist with Auto Network. Please go to our website, check out the latest videos, especially the ride and drives. We have first look section where we review automobiles. And this broadcast, as I mentioned at the head of the show, is to inform, to educate, motivate, and mobilize you, the automotive consumer. So join us not next week. That'll be Christmas. I wish you a Merry Christmas or Happy Holidays for those who don't accept the Merry Christmas offer. But as always, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. See you next time.